Hello everyone and welcome back for another episode of Indie Impressions. My name is Nick and today we're going to be looking at 48 Chambers by Discord Games. Now this is a kind of a difficult game to classify for me. I mean, I guess probably the best I could come up with is that it's sort of like a top-down version of Super Meat Boy or something. But I think the best way to go about it is just to have a look at it. But first we're going to take a quick look in the options menu. See how simple the controls are. Move on the analog stick, boost with the A button. That's it. No complicated stuff. Very simple. Got some excellent music to listen to in the background, and for the background art, we can set that or have it be random. I like the random thing because every time you die, it's going to change it to something a little bit fresher and different. And let's get into it. And I'll show you first casual mode, which is how I'm going to make some progress, and then I'm going to go into standard or hardcore. I'm not sure which one yet. Which is where the meat of the game actually lies, because it's essentially a time trials type of game. And this is how it works. So we've got this little ball guy here with an arrow pointing which direction he's going in. And you'll notice a timer counting down in the upper left-hand corner. Let that hit zero so you can see that you explode. And the premise is simply collect all these orbs, which are either 1 or 3 seconds, and proceed to the exit. And it sounds so simple, but as these types of games usually sound, they are always more complicated in the execution. And then that boost is really the risk and reward mechanism for this game. You can choose to not boost or boost. The option's up to you. A lot of the time, though, you're probably going to want to boost unless you're going to smack yourself into some spikes or something, but you will see how that works. And obviously, in casual mode, we're not too worried about getting the best time since we don't really get any scores or leaderboards or anything. But in standard and hardcore mode, where we have lives that are on the line, that will be a factor. We've got some spikes to contend with here, not a huge deal, just need to wait for those to get out of the way. And a little bit more of that. We work in a whole bunch of different traps that are more and more fiendish as we go. Thankfully my timing is not terrible, I hope, although I'm sure I will prove myself wrong there later. And this is reminding me a little bit of those spikes from like Blaster Master back in the day on the NES, walking through those little rooms with those dudes chasing you trying to get power-ups for your gun. And then we've got some, like, I don't know what you call those, so like dart traps or something in the wall. I mean, obviously the title 48 Chambers is evocative of the, you know, the martial arts like Shaolin training temples. And I believe that is what we're going for here. You need to be a little bit ninja-like, or at least have cat-like reflexes to get through some of these situations. I have to admit I was expecting more of a puzzle game when I first picked it up, but no, I was pleasantly surprised. We're going more for an action with a little bit of a puzzle tinge. And this one is definitely a dash move. So far, so good. Okay, this guy, we got a flying blade coming right at us right from the start. We want to probably watch his movements, or its movements. Need to duck into this alcove real quick. And obviously you'll notice this nice dotted line following behind us, which could be useful for sort of a, I don't want to say replay, but it's probably the closest thing to it. We can see exactly what our path was and how many times we retraced our steps, which could be useful if you're trying to shave off a few seconds toward a better time. Controls work splendidly. I mean, again, there's not much to them, but thankfully that is a good thing. We really only have to worry about a couple of things, you know, moving and dashing, and they handle just right, so there's no worries with that. The interesting trade-off is this, I don't know what you want to call it, character, icon, avatar, moves pretty slowly generally, usually a little bit slower than you'd actually want to move, but that makes a really good trade-off with the fact that you can dash. So you sort of have to weigh your ability to move versus your ability to dash at any given moment and come up with the best way around a solution for something. And sometimes you need to stand still for a second and check out your surroundings before you dive headlong into a bunch of spikes and traps. This one, not terribly difficult, but I do want to at least check out what I'm doing before I go in. Whoa, that was really close. Need to hurry up here a little bit. I'm not picking up a lot of time boosters. A little rude having those spikes right there like that. I need to hurry up and finish this one because I'm about to run out of time. Alright, so the music changed and now we've got a little bit more of a I don't know if this is more of a challenge, but I do want to get out of the way of these blades and let them go past. You need to do a little bit of thinking about your speed on a level like this. Because if I were to just walk at my normal, or walk or glide or whatever you want to call it, float, at my normal pace, I would end up pretty much getting mowed over by those, what look like lawnmower blades almost. Or ninja stars, shuriken, yeah, either one. Alright, this one takes a little bit more precise timing, obviously. We're going to need to... Whoa, that was wrong. Okay, so I died. Hey, I made it pretty far without dying, except for, like, the first level, which I died intentionally, so... Alright, we just need to time it so we hit on every other movement there, and that's not a big deal. I just wasn't paying attention enough the first time. Alright, lots of spikes here. This is giving me a little bit of an I-want-to-be-the-guy feeling. I just need to navigate carefully through... Oh, I hit the edge. If I was really crazy, I could just do some dashing, but obviously your momentum's going to catch up with you if you do any dashing at all. You probably want to take it a little carefully through this corridor. And we've got some more spinning blades here. Look like connected kunai or something. I don't know what you would call those. I'm sure they have a name, though. Actually, you can stand right here and you're perfectly safe. And then dash through that, and stick close to the inside, and you're good. A whole variety of different spikes here to worry about. Probably didn't want to dash there, but I thankfully lived anyway. Being very careful to wait for my opportunity before I move. Oh, there's so many surfaces here that are just going to kill me, but I just need to be very, very careful. And dash. Okay. Just enough time to make it through that and make it to the exit. And again, we are in casual mode. The scoring mechanism is not in place, so I don't really need to be worrying too much about that, but it does definitely add to the addictive nature of the game when you're worrying about getting a, you know, high score time trial type deal. I just went the wrong way there. Let the record reflect. If I was paying more attention, I would have noticed that the gold or yellow key lock is on the other side, and then I just made a stupid move and ran right into that shuriken. So let's head back down, grab the gold key. Ah! Trapped on the edge there. That's okay. Wait for that to pass, jump back in the alcove, make my way up. Quickly grab that red key. Now we need to duck back around because the spikes are going to prevent us from moving in that direction. Duck back into the alcove. I'm making quite a mess out of my dotted lines here. And we should have this one in the bag. Very good. You know, simplicity is really the order of the day with this game, and I think it really pulls it off very nicely. There's not a lot to really clutter the experience. The graphics, I mean, this isn't the type of game you need to worry about the graphics, but what's there is fine. I don't really have any qualms with it. I mean, the backgrounds are pleasant. They're not overwhelming. They're not distracting. The tiles that are used for the sprites on the actual art are fine. I mean, they don't look low quality. They look just fine to me. And I think that they follow a very consistent theme, which is also kind of good. Game like this, you do want to have a theme. It definitely gives it a little bit more weight to what you're trying to do. And we're not talking about a huge budget game here or anything. I mean, you can pick this up for $1 from either Xbox Live Indie Games or Desera. I believe it's also available directly from the developer. So yeah, for $1, I think you're getting quite a nice experience out of it. This one's definitely going to take a little timing. And definitely a game that is easy to play and very tough to master, which is always a good hallmark of the action-y, puzzle-y type games that we like to play on this channel. Alright, I'm really going slow here. I really needed to pick that up, but I was trying to talk and concentrate at the same time, and games like this, you really need to do one or the other, I think. Maybe that's just me. Oh man, I could have ducked right through that and didn't do it right. So it probably goes without saying, but we're going to assume there are 48 of these chambers to progress through. Not sure quite how far I am through them yet. I think I would assume I'm probably about halfway now. The challenge is definitely ratcheting up a little bit. I mean, imagine going through this on hardcore mode with exactly one life. There are no extra lives, you hit one spike one time, you lose, and you get your score uploaded to the leaderboard, which is a good challenge to want to progress through, and as a completionist myself, playing a lot of Super Meat Boy and games of that ilk, I would definitely be into that type of a challenge, although I was never one for the Iron Boy run, so, you know, maybe not entirely my thing, but I get the spirit of it at least, and I barely made it through that level. So we need to very carefully and gingerly grab this gold key. That did not work. Let us try that again. Oh, inertia. Came back to bite me on that one. Alright, let's grab this 3-second boost here, and then another one over here. We'll wait for it to come back, and we'll get right up behind it. That way we can just shoot right in that. Wait for the thing to pass again, and down we go. Open that one door for no apparent reason, and we'll grab the green key, dash out of the way, and to safety. Alright, so I think you've gotten a pretty good taste of what casual mode's about. We'll head back out to the main menu, and we will let's try hardcore mode just to show you what that's about. So the timer's still ticking, I still have the ability to dash, but we actually get our times tracked, and then that gets added to our total bonus at the end of each level, which is going to accumulate as you progress through all the levels. Again, like I said before, a very good incentive to want to keep practicing and getting better and better at this one. Plus, it's just satisfying to watch that little timer at the top tick down from, you know, being full to being empty and dropping points in your account the whole time. Alright, get our red key, let's head out to the exit. 13 seconds. So yeah, Speedrunner's Delight, I would say, definitely, if you are into that sort of gameplay, you will definitely get a lot out of this game. And the price could not be more right. I mean, how many games can you get for a dollar? I mean, I guess there's more of those nowadays than there used to be in the past, but still, it's rare that you can get a very good value for the dollar, because considering a lot of the stuff that you can find on Xbox Live indie games, because I've looked, there's a lot of crap out there. This one, thankfully, is not one of those types of games. So, we've uploaded our score. Let's take a quick look at standard mode, just for fun. That's my final score. Not very good, obviously, I could do better. So we get 3 extra lives, earn bonus points, and we get to roll up our sleeves. Thankfully, it's very hot today, so I'm wearing a short sleeve shirt. Number 3 on that checklist is not even a factor. 0 extra lives for me there. I guess maybe every so many points or something you're going to get extra lives. Gives me a little bit of a Geometry Wars feeling or something. Everything's very responsive, including the UI. The only thing that I would say is a minor... I wouldn't say it's even a complaint, but just like a minor inconvenience, is that every time you die, and this is only going to bother you in casual mode when you die constantly, but the fact that it has to load for like 2 seconds between each restart, that gets to me a little bit, because I was just sort of used to, I guess, the Super Meat Boy ethos that you immediately respawn. And those little bits and pieces of time do add up over, you know, many deaths. But again, this is only going to bother you on casual mode, because otherwise you would have been out of the game by then, and it probably wouldn't matter too much to you. Chose to go over those spikes very, very slowly. Probably not the best idea. Let's let that go. Oh, I didn't wait long enough. I was trying to rush through, and that is never a good idea. But, you know, it's an interesting counterbalance when you want to rush because you're against the clock, but at the same time you want to take it carefully and meticulously so you don't die. Dashing, you know, it seems like a great idea, but there's an awful lot of spikes, so, you know, you got to make the best of it. And if you miss one of those green orbs, it's not the end of the world, it's just you probably want them to get as high a score as possible. But you are not required by any means to collect all of them to progress through the end of each level. And we'll just keep playing this until I finish out my 3 lives, which I'm sure won't take very long, given the difficulty that this game gets to as we progress a little bit higher up in the levels. Whoa, why would I do that? That was a really bad idea. I needed to just rush through that whole mess of spikes there. Forget about those ones on the side. Oh, I get another I got an extra life again. Wow. Game's pretty generous with that, I suppose. So yeah, I would assume that the proper path to greatness as far as 48 Chambers goes is to practice quite a bit on casual mode, get your chops up, and then head on into standard or maybe hardcore if you're a masochist, and just keep beating yourself against the wall until you beat it. I assume this would get easier and easier the more time you put in. I mean, once you learn the levels, I could imagine it would get much simpler. The first time I played this level, I actually struggled a bit, just because I couldn't seem to, like, parse the timing of those spikes going up and down. I'm not sure why. Just occasionally you get stuck on something stupid like that. Trying to do it a little bit faster. If I was really fast, I could probably shoot back up without even waiting for that thing to rotate again. I think I did fairly well on that one. I wonder if you're allowed to even have more than 3 lives. Maybe it caps at 3 lives, and then as soon as you get 2, then you enter the, like, will I get another life realm or something. Alright, this one should be no problem. And I do want to mention again, the music is very good at the, in this particular game. I've turned it down quite a bit so I can hear, or so you can hear me speak. But this is definitely a game that you're going to want to play with the music up. And there's enough variety on the different tracks that you're definitely going to want to hear it, without a doubt. So props to the audio director for Discord Games. Very good stuff. In fact, not just the music, but the sound effects in general all seem very nice. I have no complaints in that department at all. You know, it's always nice to see when a game is developed without, you know, the loftiest of aspirations as far as being, like, the best bump map, high-tech first-person shooter. You know, it has a sort of a humble goal in mind to be a good puzzle platform, action-y type of game. And they don't go too crazy worrying about the frills, because they just make sure that the stuff that's here is competent and really, you know, polished and well done. And I think that there's a lot to be said for developers who know their strengths and play to them, and don't go too crazy trying to do stuff that in the long run really doesn't make a difference to whether or not the game is good. Because really, it's all about gameplay. You know, adding on all kinds of tacked-on modes that don't really do anything to elevate the experience, I don't see the point in that, and I think it wastes everyone's time. And in the end, I mean, the hope a lot of the time is to put another bullet point on the back of somebody's box. And in this case, we're not worried about that. We just have a fun game to play, we got some levels to learn, some challenges to overcome, and, you know, that's really all we're worried about. Everything that's here is polished, everything is fun, and that's good enough. So let that be a lesson to more developers out there. You know, play to your strengths, do what you know what you can do right. Polish everything that you have till it's perfect, if you can. And I think that's one of the best things about indie games, is a lot of the time, and I know this isn't the case every time, whoa, crap, that was terrible. This isn't the case every time, but for a lot of people, developing an indie game happens usually on their own terms, the developer's terms. And again, I know that there are plenty of extenuating circumstances, but it does usually give you the opportunity to realize... Oh, that was really dumb. Why did I dash? Realize the vision that you may have had personally or as a small group, a small team, whatever. Which is just... It really brings out so many better games because we don't have to worry about designing things by focus group or, you know, any of that politics stuff that gets involved when we get into the bigger budget AAA style games. And even the mid-tier games start to get like that after a while too. Or I should say even like the upper division big budget indie games. And there's not a lot of those, but you know, that occasionally does creep in. Alright, I think I got a handle on this level. This one wasn't that hard. I also find that the difficulty scaling for this particular game, I think it goes quite evenly, which I appreciate. I mean, maybe there's a couple of exceptions, but for the most part I felt like I was on a pretty gradual incline with the occasional minor dip, and maybe that dip was just based on my ability to handle each instance. Whoa, okay. So you gotta wait for that. Go, 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 go. Got it. So you'll see, even just from me playing my first time in casual mode, I think I've already gotten a little bit better at this, and I think I have about a combined total of about a half an hour's worth of gameplay on this. Maybe a little bit more than that, like 45 minutes. Because I did play this for a bit before I started. Alright, I think I got this one, as long as I don't go too slowly. Got it, perfect. And I'm still at 4 lives, which I'm quite surprised to see. The only thing I might have wanted, if I was to want something, and I know that I just finished with my rant about, like, play to your strengths, don't add unnecessary stuff, but if I was to want anything about this, I would say add a level editor, perhaps. Even if it's just for local play, for the player to design, you know, cunning and fiendish traps for themselves and for their friends, I think that could be fun. But I do know that adding stuff like that adds a lot of unnecessary, you know, complications to the development process a lot of the time. And especially if you get into lofty stuff like doing multiplayer, adding online stuff, that can all get really complicated, and especially for a studio, if you are a studio that is just starting out, I imagine. You know, I'm not technically an indie developer myself, but this is just what I would imagine in my head. Go. Alright, this might be the last level for me if I can't navigate these traps successfully. Maybe I can. Let's see. Okay, barely made it. That spike was about to cut my back open. Alright, this might be the last one, though. Alright, so I gotta go for the gold key, not take too long, not get hit by darts, not get hit by spikes. I got hit by the dart. Game over. Alright, I think I did fairly well. And I hope you guys enjoyed this fairly comprehensive look at 48 Chambers. Definitely recommended. The price is right, the gameplay's solid, I don't have any real complaints about it. I think you could do a lot worse for a dollar. So definitely give them a check. I will put the link, as always, in the description of the video, so head on over there and look them up. So, as always, remember, head on over to facebook.com/indieimpressions, where I post every night's video. This is like the 118th or 19th video in a row that I've done consecutively. So feel free to share them with friends, let people know the series is going. I totally rely on you guys to help me out, so any help that you can provide is a massive, massive thanks to you guys. I have to say, like, the power that one person can have for determining the future of my channel is immense. On Reddit, a little while ago, one person added me to a single thread that got me over 250 subscribers in one day, so if you guys feel the compulsion to help me out, I thank you more than anything. Like, that's all I could ask for. So if you feel that this is a good show, you want to pass it on to people, if you want to help me out, that's one way you can do it. Let people know about it. I really value it. And really, word of mouth is like one of the few ways that stuff like this can really reach more people. I mean, I do what I can to let people know about it, but I really am thankful for what you guys can do to help. Beyond that, also, I have Twitter, at RockLeeSmile and at IndieImpressions. At RockLeeSmile is my personal account. I show up and talk about random stuff on there. And then at IndieImpression, if you follow that one, you're going to find out exactly when every video is uploaded. And you will be able to also retweet those to friends if you like. But that's totally up to you guys. So that will do it for today's episode. Thank you again for watching. And remember to stop back again tomorrow for another one. All right, have a great day, guys, and thank you again. Later.